Well, it is. Hello. It is time for us to begin this morning. So if everybody can start making their way in, I just appreciate all the fellowship going on. Be sure to grab a communion cup as you make your way to your seat. And as you get there, definitely want to encourage you to fill out one of the communication cards that'll be picked up towards the end of service. We welcome you here this morning. We also welcome those of you who are joining us online. It is good to be here together today. Good morning, church. Well, today is a special day from one sort in that we're having our annual trunk or treat today. And so I just want to thank all of you who have donated candy, those of you who have signed up to be a part of the event tonight, whether you're hosting a trunk, whether you're helping out at the fire pit, whether you're helping clean up, whether you're helping set up, do any of those things. Just want to so much appreciate those of you who have given time, energy, and effort to this opportunity. And if you still would like to participate in some way, but you forgot to sign up or forgot to do anything, please just come see me after church, reach out to me, shoot me a text, anything like that. If you want to help, we would be more than happy to have you involved in some way. But even on top of that, even if you aren't able to help in some way, even if you can just come and be here and be present and interact, it's a great opportunity for us to interact not only with each other, but definitely an opportunity for us to engage with our community around us and just interact with them, meet them, greet them, love on them, and just experience fellowship with them. And if nothing else, even if you can't even be here tonight, we just ask for your prayers. We ask you to be praying over this event just for good weather. I know kind of the, who knows, it's supposed to be overcast, but hopefully that we just have a good evening together. Just pray for the event, but also pray for the opportunity, just the opportunity for us to engage with our community. And so please just be placing that before God in prayer this evening. Well, this morning we have come just to be together, come together as a community of faith, come together and rejoice in God, rejoice in all that he is doing, to be glad in his presence and just to be filled with his joy. To be filled with his love as a reminder of what he has offered us, what he has given to us, and even the responsibility in that to offer to others. And what other response should we have than just to give our hearts to him, to offer him our love, to offer him our praise, and just to offer him our lives, knowing that the fullness of life comes in who he is, the fullness of life comes in what he does. And so as we begin this morning, now, we're going to start this morning in a time of prayer, just collective and commune together in prayer before God. And as we move into this time, I just want to ask for just a moment of silence, just a time to contemplate why we're here, to allow our hearts, to allow our minds to focus on our King, on our Father who loves us, who desires us to be with him, and that we just invite him into this space to be here with us as we worship, honor, and glorify him. So let's just take just a few moments of silence, and then we'll enter into a time of prayer.
Won't you please bow with me? Most gracious Father and Almighty God, thank you for this time we have with you this morning, permitting us to gather to offer song and praise. May our hearts be glad while our minds are focused on you, our Holy Father, in this assembly. We ask that you continue to bless our church, our families, our friends. Please comfort the loved ones experiencing recent tragic loss in Maine last week, as well as the continued crisis in Israel and Gaza. We know as Christians that ungodly evil abounds in this world, and it has always been the devil's playground. May you enable us to stand united against Satan and his demons as they promote chaos and destruction Father, we further ask that you be with the leaders and lawmakers of our nation as we pray that their actions are always aligned with your will for us. May they dismiss selfish pride while demonstrating the model your Son Jesus provided as per your instruction. That would be servant leadership. It is our hope that you accept our burdens as we know that through you all things are possible. May we be mindful of your blessings, Lord, both great and small, the visible as well as the invisible, and be thankful as we do not ever mean to take you or your gifts for granted, Father. Please be with those who are not present or unable to join us this morning. We ask that you bless the trunk or treat event tonight, that it be safe, engaging, and encouraging for everyone. These things we ask in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
The scripture reading is from Isaiah 6, 1 through 8. It says, "In the year of King Uzzah's death, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, lofty and exalted, with the train of his robe filling the temple. Seraphim stood above him, each having six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called out to another and said, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.' And the foundations and the thresholds trembled at the voice of him who called out, with the temple was filling with smoke. Then I said, 'Woe is me, for I am ruined, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.' Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a burning coal in his hand, which he had taken from the altar with tongs. He touched my mouth with it and said, 'Behold, this has touched your lips, and your iniquity is taken away from you, and your sin is forgiven.' Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?' Then I said, 'Here I am, send me.'"
Let me add a word of welcome that Matt has shared this morning. We're going to be doing things just a little bit differently. We're going to be splitting the study part of our lesson into two particular parts. We're going to start by looking at the text and its setting, and then I'll return later in our time together, our assembly, to kind of bring some closure to the passage. And so I would draw your attention back as we had the reading from David to Isaiah chapter 6 in your Bible or in or on your particular device. In our American form of government, we only have a president traditionally for two terms in office, a period of about 8 years. There was one president, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, who was elected to 4 terms. And as a result of that, after the end of World War II, we got the 22nd Amendment to the Constitution that makes sure that that'll never happen again. So all presidents are only going to serve for 8 years. Last year in September, Queen Elizabeth II passed away. She had reigned for over 70 years in England and was the only monarch, the only ruler that a whole generation of Britons had known. But of course, it's a little bit different because she doesn't have real power. Most of her power is symbolic. It's contained and is there from Parliament. That's where real power is wielded. And so therefore, when we step back and we hear these words at the beginning of Isaiah chapter 6, it's probably very difficult for us to understand the true impact here, the level of shock and confusion that lies behind these words. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. Now, Uzziah is a critically important figure from a historical viewpoint from the nation of Judah as its ruler, probably second only to David and Solomon. He comes to power at a key historical moment, a juncture that really will shape three generations of people in that kingdom. He will reign for 52 years. He's not as well known to us because we don't have a lot of details, just kind of an overview about some of the things that happened in his reign. Now, we know that he ascends to the throne at a time when some of the world powers are shifting around. Syria, with their capital at Damascus, had really been the major focal point since the time of Solomon and had kept Israel and Judah kind of down, if you will. And now Assyria begins to flex its muscles, and its capital is to the north in Nineveh. And so now Syria has to worry about what's going on north of them, and it kind of frees Judah and Israel to seek their own way once again. And so we have those nations beginning to flourish. And Jeroboam II and King Uzziah will lead their respective nations in a period of peace and prosperity and expansion. Now, again, we don't have a lot of the details, but the overview of the exploits are found in 2 Chronicles chapter 26. And there we read, he, that is Uzziah, went to war against the Philistines and broke down the walls of Gath and Ashdod, and then rebuilt towns near Ashdod and elsewhere among the Philistines. God helped him against the Philistines and against the Arabs. The Ammonites brought tribute to Uzziah, and his fame spread as far as the border of Egypt because he had become very powerful. Uzziah built towers in Jerusalem at the corner gate, at the valley gate, and at the angle of the wall, and he fortified them. Later, we are told that he had an army of 307,500 men, and as opposed to what was common in the time, he actually provided all of the armor for them. And as a result, the summary is given to us in verse 15, that his fame spread far and wide, and he was greatly helped until he became powerful. Uzziah, again, his reign is viewed as being second most only to David and Solomon in terms of its impact. But in this same text, the recording is given to us, but when he was strong, he grew proud to his destruction. Uzziah decides, for whatever reason, that as the king, he ought to offer incense in the temple to God, even though that was not to be done according to the law. And so he enters into the temple. He offers or tries to offer that incense. He is confronted by the priest at that point. And instead of being repentant, he becomes angry. And as a result of his anger, he is stricken with leprosy. And because of that leprosy, he must leave the area of Jerusalem, and his son takes over as co-regent for the last years of his reign. And the nation begins to walk a new pathway. The first five chapters of the book of Isaiah are kind of a preview of the difficulties that are going to confront the nation. And the prophet records that there are serious moral and spiritual issues that begin to present themselves. Among the leaders, among many of the people themselves, there is a growing sense of greed and hedonism. They plan evil. They distort the truth according to what Isaiah records in those five chapters. And they forsake the Lord, not so much by creating a new worship to idols, but they just go through the old worship, but without their real passion and heart being connected to it. And what you start to see is it kind of looks like a parent with a rebellious teenager. They just don't want to hear it. They just don't want to deal with it. And as a result of that, the people start to despise and to disown the Lord. And what you end up with is estrangement. Now, as we examine this, this background, I hope, allows us to understand how traumatic this event is. So that when King Uzziah dies, now there are all kinds of questions that are going to be raised. Will the countries around them begin to reassert their activities and press in? Will this new ruler be able to continue the peace and prosperity and health that they have enjoyed? Will the army be able to be held together? These are all questions that are there. What will the future look like now that Judah's throne is empty? And so Isaiah 6 begins in the year that King Uzziah died. Now, there is a dramatic contrast that comes here in these words in Isaiah chapter 6. It starts as Isaiah is wondering about this crisis in his homeland and where the future is going to go. And it ends with a vision in which he is transported to the very throne room of God. And as this scene unfolds before him, all of the troubling questions that he has in his mind are being swallowed in this glorious moment, a moment that is captured in this singular phrase, "I saw the Lord." Uzziah, the king, may be dead, but God still is sitting on the throne. And he has a vision that, as it was read to us this morning, embraces all of the senses. He sees God sitting on the throne. He hears the call of the seraphim as they are there around the throne. He smells the smoke. He feels the trembling. His lips are touched with the coal, so he tastes the coal. It is a powerful, awe-inspiring, and frightening scene. And it is one that is incredibly interesting as we examine its details. Because this throne, you see, is absolutely enormous. It is enormous, so much so that he's not able to see the whole thing. He really only sees the bottom half of it. And God's robe, more accurately as it's translated, just the hem around the bottom of his robe, fills all of the heavenly temple that he can see. In very high-end, extravagant, formal weddings, women will oftentimes have a train that is on their wedding gown. Princess Diana had the longest of any monarch for a wedding. It was 25 feet. Well, imagine a robe that is so long that it goes all the way down the center aisle, and then wraps around the outer aisles and then piles up into the pews. That's what's being described here. And then there are these mysterious critters called seraphim, okay? A unique phrase. They're never, ever referred to in Scripture again. And they have three pairs of wings, and it's very significant. The first pair covers their eyes because God is so holy and glorious, they can't even see the face of God. And then two cover their feet, the most common part of the body, okay? And yet then they're flying, and incessantly they are calling out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And when they finish that, they say it again and again and again. And we hear that God is holy. When we hear that, we usually think of that relating to God's purity. And it's true that God is purity. He has no immoral thoughts, no wrong motives, okay? He's perfectly pure. But this is more than that. This holiness means that he has no equal. And we read that in Isaiah as an example, chapter 40, verse 25. "To whom then will you compare me that I should be like him?" In other words, he has no equal. And God continues to speak in Isaiah 45, verse 5, declaring, I am the Lord, there is no other. There is none like our God, and it is folly to compare Him to anyone or anything, because He is completely incomparable. Now, again, staying with some of these details, the text is a little bit ambiguous because it tells us that there is a voice here. We're not told if it's the voice of a seraphim or if it's the voice of God. The result is given to us, and that is that the entire building trembles. This throne is enormous, okay? It is there, but now it is shaking. It is trembling. It rattles the temple to its foundation. You know, I've been at concerts. I've been at football games. I've been at outings and other events where the bass is such a low rumble that you can absolutely just feel it inside of you. And that's kind of what Isaiah is getting here. And this moment, this vision touches him absolutely to the very core. So much so that he will literally never, ever be the same again. Now, as we shift from this picture of worship to preparation for our worship this morning, I'm going in our greater lesson to make three parallels, but we're just going to start with the first of these. In our day today, we face many uncertainties. A large number of our leaders are aged. We have a president who's 80. His main contender is 77. Nancy Pelosi is 83. Mitch McConnell, the leader of the Republicans in the Senate, is 81. The majority Republican Party in the House of Representatives just recently spent three very contentious weeks trying to find a leader. And it's illustrative of the political turmoil that we face in our nation today. We have a looming deadline coming up in mid-November to pass a budget, or the government is going to shut down. And if the government shuts down, we think we may have some economic issues. It would really be difficult at that point. The Federal Reserve has been trying to get the economy, inflation, under control. They've done some of that, okay, but they've moved interest rates from 0 to 5.25%. And that has impacted us. A home mortgage has gone from 3% to 8%. And so there are economic clouds that are there on the horizon. And, of course, there is a war in the Middle East. Thousands of civilians have died on both sides. And frankly, there is no end in sight to what's happening there. There are 220-plus hostages. No one knows what the fate is going to be for them. Is this going to expand into a regional conflict or war? We don't know. And it's kind of removed from the front page the fact that Russia and Ukraine continue to be in a grinding conflict there. And we have other hot spots around the world. And so we gather together this morning at a key moment. In the year that King Uzziah died, Isaiah saw God. And he had a vision of God. And that vision swallowed up all of his fear and his uncertainty. I think that has key insights for us. Because in our moments of loss and uncertainty and in confusion, the thing that makes everything find its proper place is encountering God, is encountering God. And so as we worship the Lord this morning, I pray that you too will be able to capture a glimpse of God, glorious and holy, with his robes filling his temple. Let's stand together as we worship God in song.
falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb, and all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. If you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the Lamb. If you walk in freedom, and if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. We'll sing the song forever and amen, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear your people sing, holy, to the King of Kings, holy, you will always be, holy, holy forever. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear your people sing, holy, to the King of Kings, holy, you will always be, holy, holy forever. You will always be, holy, holy forever. Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God over all and blessed eternally. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the crystal sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, oh, wast and art and evermore shalt be. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty God over all and blessed eternally. In moments like these, I sing out a song, I sing out a love song to Jesus. In moments like these, I lift up my voice, I lift up my voice to the Lord, singing, I love you, Lord. Singing, I love you, Lord. Singing, I love you, Lord, I love you. In moments like these, I sing out a song, I sing out a love song to Jesus. In moments like these, I lift up my voice, I lift up my voice to the Lord, singing, I love you, Lord. Singing, I love you, Lord. Singing, I love you, Lord, I love you. Lord, you gave your life for me. Through your love you set me free. Paid the price I could not pay. Took my sin and guilt away. Lord, I praise your holy name. You have cleansed my sin and shame. On the cross you paid the price with your perfect sacrifice. Holy Father, loving God, you have saved me through your word. You have shown your grace to me through your gift of love so free. Yes, Lord, I love you. Yes, Lord, I love you. Yes, Lord, I love you, because you first loved me. Please be seated.
This from Luke 22:14-22. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took the bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup, is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with me on the table. The Son of Man will go as he has been decreed, but woe to the man who betrays him." Will you bow with me? Dear Lord, thank you so much for your Son who died on our behalf, for sinners, unworthy, but you still found in your heart to make a way for salvation. Dear Lord, it's hard to imagine someone who would betray Jesus, even one of his closest friends. But that just makes the story even that more powerful, that he could give forgiveness to those who betrayed him. I want to be mindful of that in all things. The body that was broken on the cross, that was represented by the bread, the blood that was shed on the cross, that the juice represents, in all things, to give thanks to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and Friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost our way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own. Here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. He taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand.
So we've discussed some of the details of what Isaiah sees, but really these are real just descriptions of something more dramatic, more fundamental. Seven things that Isaiah glimpses here. The first is that King Uzziah may be dead, but God is alive. And God is on that throne. That means that he has authority. He is lifted up. That shows that he has the highest of powers. There are these creatures that are giving this statement, offering up unending reverence for God. And it's a picture of God's complete and transcendent holiness. And the real manifestation of that holiness is into God's glory. So how does Isaiah respond? Well, I'll tell you what he doesn't do. He doesn't kind of blurt out something like Peter does. You remember when he's on the Mount of Transfiguration? Oh, God, boy, it's great that we're here. Instead, there is a very different response that Isaiah brings on. It is one of sheer terror. The New International says, I am ruined. The English Standard says, I am lost. The New Century says, oh no, I am destroyed. Why does Isaiah have that sense? Because of the juxtaposition between the glory and the holiness of God, and his sinful condition has now been exposed. And it is the most dramatic contrast imaginable. It is black and white. It is light and darkness. And I think it is helpful if we were to compare the response of Uzziah when he sins to that of Isaiah. Uzziah, you'll remember, you know, he gets mad, he gets angry, he defends himself. But Isaiah is ashamed, he is crushed, he is repentant. And the response to heaven is immediate. A coal is taken from the altar and touches his lips, and he is forgiven of his sin. I said when we started that we can see ourselves in this wonderful vision. I shared that there were three parallels. Here's the second. That first item was that we, as we encounter God in our times of difficulty, we need to see God then. The second item is that we spend more than just a few moments in thinking about God. And we think about Him as the Creator and the Sovereign and the Ruler. We're crushed, just like Isaiah. I appreciated so much Phil's song selection this morning as we prepared for communion, because we talked about holiness, and the song had the line, "All creation cries, holy, you are lifted up, holy, holy forever." And then that song that repeated similar words to the creatures, "Holy, holy, holy, thou art holy, there is none beside you." In Isaiah, we see our response. Because like Isaiah, we are destroyed. We are ruined. And I'm convinced that this order that is unpacked here in this particular text is critical. Too often when people are confronted about their sin, they begin to do a comparison to their peers, a comparison to those who are around them. "Well, I'm not as bad as she is. I'm not as big a gossip as they are. I'm not as immoral as him." But as we stand before the throne of God, the standard is different. It's not others. It's not how I'm doing around me. Instead, the contrast is to God. It is to God and His splendor and His holiness and His glory. And when that occurs, there is a singular response. Paul writes in the book of Romans, Romans chapter 14, about all humanity at one time standing before the throne of God. And you may remember the response. It is a quote from Isaiah. "As surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will acknowledge God." I don't care if you are the most self-assured sinner. It all ends in the same place, before the full holiness and glory of God. We are on our knees. And it's in the aftermath of this time of forgiveness that there is a divine question that is posited. Who shall I send? Who will go? Now, with an inspired purpose, Isaiah speaks up. "Here am I," he says, "send me." Do you see how those are all connected? He sees God, he sees his low estate, he is forgiven by God, and now he is motivated and moved and able to take on the task that God has. It is a huge transformation, but it is perfectly comprehensible, is it not? Again, I will argue that it is instructive for us too. I think, you know, we've really messed up some of the proper progression that is intended here. We too often try to move people without their having a full sense of their forgiveness. We ask people to seek forgiveness when they don't recognize their sin. And therefore, I don't think you effectively get to where Isaiah finds himself here unless you walk this pathway. We will only really be able to fully embrace God's call when we experience it as Isaiah did. And frankly, that's why this lesson and really all these stories of Scripture are not just interesting tales from millennia ago. You see, God hasn't changed. He still is holy. humanity hasn't changed. We are still vile sinners. Forgiveness hasn't changed. It is still a gift given by God. And the tasking hasn't changed. There's an obligation to take what we have received to those who are around us. And that, you see, brings us right back to where we started, into the very throne room of God. God loves us. God sent His Son Jesus to save us, to forgive us. Have you received that? Have you obeyed Him? Have you followed Him? This morning, it's important that we think through those questions. And then, once we have received that forgiveness, are we being used by God for His mission? Does He have a calling for us, something that He wants us to do, people that He wants us to reach out to and to serve and to connect with? If this morning you need to embrace your mission, if this morning you need to put Jesus on as your Savior to be forgiven of your sins, we encourage you to make your way to the front at this time while together we stand and while we sing.
I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing, I will sing, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. With my mouth will I make known your faithfulness. With my mouth will I make known your faithfulness to all generations. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing, I will sing, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. With my mouth will I make known your steadfastness, your steadfastness. With my mouth will I make known your steadfastness to all generations. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing, I will sing, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. You are Lord of creation and Lord of my life, Lord of the land and the sea. You were Lord of the heavens before there was time, and Lord of all lords you will be. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. Lord of all lords you will be. You are King of creation and King of my life, King of the land and the sea. You were King of the heavens before there was time, and King of all kings you will be. We bow down and we crown you the King. We bow down and we crown you the King. We bow down and we crown you the King. King of all kings you will be.
Please be seated.
What a blessing it is to be able to come together and to worship King Jesus and praise him together. And what an awesome blessing that is. And thank you for your presence this morning. Thank you for being here and for the love that you show to each other, and more importantly, the love you have for Christ as well. I just want to remind you of a few things we have going on. One, we forgot to put in the bulletin, but just a reminder, next Saturday night, there is a time change. So don't forget to move your clocks back 1 hour next week. If you show up here and forgot to move your clocks back, just wait around. We'll get around to it. Also, right now, you can pass your communications cards to the side, and our kids will collect those as well. And then, as Matt mentioned, just invite you tonight for Trunk or Treat. That's from 5:30 to 7, so invite any neighbors and friends for that event, and encourage you to come out. Even if you did not sign up, like Matt said, just let him know. If you'd like to still host a trunk or do any of that. And if you don't want to host anything, just come and be part of it and just engage with the community and just share Christ's love. We'll have a fire pit set up, which is a great opportunity just to gather around the fire and enjoy conversation. And we'll have hot dogs and water. So nothing big. It won't be a full meal, but just keep that in mind. As well, and s'mores as well around the fire. And then next Saturday, November 4th, we'll have our prayer walk and Second Mile Haiti walk, our prayer breakfast at 8 o'clock here in the fellowship hall. So make plans to come at 8, bring food to share, enjoy that time, and then we'll be going after that to Stratford High School to their track to do the walk following our breakfast. And then also just want to give an update and just highlight just the family at East End that we've been helping. One, just thank you for the support that's been given, the money donated, the items donated, just to help this family. We've been able to do two different deliveries to their apartment, and to say she has been thankful is probably an understatement. And just it was such a blessing to be able to go and to deliver those things and to pray with her and just encourage her. But there are still some items that they are in need of. We've been able to donate some beds, but they're still in need of a toddler bed. There is in need of a bed for the mother as well. Living room furniture, microwave, and different items. So if there's any items you're able to donate, just contact me, let me know, and we'll be able to organize to get those to her, to the family. But even more than that, let's continue to pray for her, and just as they're still grieving the loss of her husband and their father, and just with five kids, and so just continue to to encourage, to be praying for them. And let us continue to be praying for all those who are on our prayer list. It is so good to see Clay this morning, and just continue to be lifting him up and Melissa Kelly and just all those who are on the prayer list, Mary, and be praying for each other. And just let's close in prayer this morning. Father, you are so good, so good. We love you so much, Father. We pray that you will guide us just as we go about today, just that we will just shine with your love. And Father, I pray that you bless tonight. Father, may it be a night where we are able to engage the community, and not just to bring treats or fun, but really that your love will be seen, your glory will be seen. And Father, may you work through us, through our jobs, through our neighborhoods, through our everyday life. May you use us for your glory. May your kingdom grow. And may we be filled with your love. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. All right, you are dismissed.